Hello, welcome to another edition of Music Cafe. We have a special guest today, and it's a little bit different than every week. I hope everybody's doing fine, staying safe wherever you are around the world. We're reaching you via Facebook, YouTube, and of course on Music Cafe TV. I am very happy to bring in today's co-host, who has been with us in the past, but it's great to have you back, Leandro Oliveira, joining us from Sao Paulo. Leandro, bem-vindo.
How are you doing? Muito obrigado. Bom dia. How are you doing,
well,
Alex?
I'm doing great. Thank you for having us again.
Thank you for inviting me.
Fantastic. I have a coffee. I think you have coffee there as well.
Me too.
It's great to have you. Coffee. Excellent. You should be having Brazilian coffee, to tell you the truth.
Yeah, I know. Okay.
It's a special Brazilian day. Exactly. Fantastic, fabulous special guest we have today. And before we bring her in, let's see a little bit of her participation in with the BBC Cardiff Orchestra. Fabulous participation that she did last year in Singer of the World. Let's go see. What is there to say, Leandro? Not a lot.
What a voice, huh?
What a voice. So let's welcome our guest today, Camila Tittinger. Camila, thank you very, very much.
Thank you for having me, Alex and Leandro. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure. And I'm here also with my coffee.
They're
enjoying. Oh, great.
We're all.
Cheers.
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 In some part of the world, they're drinking something stronger at this time.
Oh,
but
yeah,
we start with coffee. And thank you for joining us. What a tremendous pleasure. Camila, I want to start as close as the beginning as possible. So how did you start? I know you started with not with opera, but singing. How did that come along? How did a girl from Sao Paulo decided to sing?
Well, I come from a family of doctors, of physicians, and my grandmother was she was practicing at their time when I was born, gynecologist. She was a gynecologist. My dad is a cardiologist. My brother as well. So I always thought that I would be following this path as well. So my mom, when she was pregnant of me, she did piano in Santa Marcelina. And then when I was born until my 6 years old, I was accompanying her every time in her recitals, in her, she was always organizing some little recitals, concerts, events in general. And then suddenly I was, I remember quite well, used to hear a lot of good music, if I may say that. Not that other types of music are not good, but she was always putting me in contact with the most traditional popular music, the Brazilian popular music, all like Elis Regina, singing things of Tom Jobim, for example, you know, this kind of of quality music that we have a lot, Villa-Lobos as well. And then I got in contact with classical music because of my grandfather, her dad, who is Italian from Rome, and he was living here from since the times of the war when he came here, and he met my grandmother. And then, well, the thing is that I was so used to that environment of listening to music. I don't know, 6 years old, I saw myself in the mirror. My mom used to play those pictures for us, for me and my brother, Disney classics, but from streamed by Cultura, the TV Cultura.
TV Cultura.
And it was not the original pictures, but like films inspired on Disney classics. And then I certainly saw myself in the mirror. And then I don't know, I think as I remember that I saw one of the princes or that I wanted to be. And then I started to sing. And literally my mom and my dad were passing by this corridor that we have here at their house. I'm in São Paulo right now during these difficult times that we are passing by. And we have a big mirror there with a corridor between the bedrooms. And then literally they saw me there. I was shocked because they were looking at me. And then suddenly I realized, oh, I'm singing. And I like what I'm hearing. And I could notice that they were liking as well what they were hearing. And then, well, my mom, and as my dad is also a doctor, he had a professor who is a laryngologist. And my mom was very afraid to put me into singing class having 6 years old. So basically what I did was beginning piano classes, ballet classes. She put me in all arts environment, you know. So choir, ballet, and piano classes I had that time. And then my dad was sending me to this laryngologist every month or so to see if my vocal cords were good. So the support that they gave to me that time was extremely important. I felt embraced by my family, and I know that I've been very lucky to have that. It's not everyone that has this luck. And literally was like that. I began singing musicals by Disney. And then after that, I was in touch with everything that Elis Regina was singing back then. So many, many composers that I used to love, like Edu Lobo, Chico Buarque, Tom Jobim, and many others as well. After that, I was introduced into singing class only when I was 15 years old.
Before you go there, before you go to that part, I took the liberty of, or I will take the liberty of making you blush. I'm going to show you a little clip that we found somewhere on the internet. You can tell us.
I started blushing already. Oh my God, João Cristal, my dear friend, singing Luisa. Wow.
Uma espada nua, boia no céu imensa e amarela, tão redonda a lua como flutua. Vem navegando azul do firmamento e no silêncio lento, trovador cheio de estrelas. Escuta agora a canção que eu fiz pra te esquecer, Luisa.
Oh, you wanna make me cry.
Whoa. So that's a very young Camila.
How old were you there?
It was a beautiful time that I that I had when I was competing in this. Well, it was literally my first competition. I think I have this profile of wanting to not have competitors actually, but to challenge myself into the steps of life, you know. So as I come from São Paulo, Brazil, I always wanted to feel that I was challenging myself to this new beginnings of my life, and that's why I enjoyed so much that period of Prêmio Visa de MPB, this competition. I risk here to say, I think that was the last or almost the last edition of the competition. It doesn't exist anymore. And I was very lucky to be able to sing there and to have this experience on stage with the fear. I can notice that I was like trembling, fighting against the fear, but with the confidence that I already had, so being so young, that not the confidence in myself, but the confidence that I needed to do that, that I needed to be on stage, that I needed to sing, that this would be part of my life for the rest of my life. And that's what I hope.
That's awesome.
It's really amazing.
How old were you then?
I was 12. I was 12, exactly 12.
Wow.
It's
great to find these clips because I see your smile and then at 15 you were telling us you went into classical music.
At 15 I began classes with Leila Farah, who was a very famous teacher here in Brazil. Everyone wanted to have classes with her, and actually I also have to thank my mom again, because as she was in love with singing, with piano, with everything that regarding music, she was taking classes with Leila Farah, and then she convinced Leila that I was not too young to begin, because I was already singing for since a long time, since my 9 years old professionally, and I forgot to mention that I had some experiences in a TV program that used to call Gente Inocente at Globo, and that was my first professional experience, not on stage like live as the Prêmio Visa de MPB, but in a TV program as we were recording, and then it would be on air. And so I began very, very early, with 9 years old. And then my mom was telling Leila, well, she has to have singing classes with someone that can give her a direction, the right direction. Because it is Alex and Leandro, it is very dangerous to begin on lyric singing without the right direction. It can be very demanding. With the presence and the intensity of the voice that we need in the lyric singing to project without the microphone, so it really needs a technique, a solid technique. So mm-hmm. This beginning is very important. Then this teacher agreed with giving me classes, and then I began. It was really like everything that I was putting myself into it and all my efforts, I was seeing the results. It was all, it was like this from the beginning till now.
Great. I have a question. You have been you're living between Europe and Brazil for a while now.
Yes.
And I would love to listen about how you feel in this transition, all of this. How you're feeling and how it was.
Yes, of course. So I began to live in Europe. Well, I have family there in Italy, which is very good to have. But I never lived with them. despite of many things that I was dealing here with university, that I didn't want to give up on the university that I was, UNESP, some opportunities came to me, like going to Italy and trying to sing for Rai Italiana, that TV, but I would be like Laura Pausini kind of singer. So
really?
I love her, but I wanted to follow the path of lyric singing. So then I had a proposition from Robert Harrison to go to Indiana University in Bloomington, I think. Yeah.
Yep.
In the United States. And then I refused that, which was very, very hard for me to do, because I was still not ready to go out of Brazil. I'm very attached with my family here, and it was a very big decision. So I think, as always, life puts the right things for me to do and kind of like pushes me, you know, to do things that I have to. I met, like, really by coincidence, I met Plácido Domingo in a competition that I did, and he and his wife offered me to go to Valencia, Spain, to study and to complete my studies after the university, to go to Palau de las Artes Reina Sofia and to do my opera studio there. So the first time that I really lived out of Brazil was in Spain, Valencia. Mm. And this was not so far away from now. It was not so long ago, 2017 to 2018, in the transition of almost New Year's Eve, I was there. And then since 2018, I've been living in Europe, and then I suddenly saw that my life was going to UK, because I was doing the BBC Cardiff Singer of the World. Then Garsington Opera Festival hired me to sing Donna Anna, and I was having my debut in this big character, and also with Garsington Opera Festival. Then I had some other contracts that I hope I will have the chance to sing this year, La Traviata of Opera North. La Traviata Violeta with Opera North, that it's a British company. And
as I've Violeta, really?
Then.
Great, as Violeta.
You forgot to mention that you also won the Maria Callas competition.
Yes, this was a very, very big and important competition here in Brazil, because it was from Paulo Esper, who is a great, great guy and great administrator of everything that regards to theater competition, everything. He is from this world. He just gave to us, to all of us from the competition, to have an international jury. So this gave us the opportunity to show our work to the world, literally, because they were most of them directors of important theaters, casting directors, actually, singers as well. And then this was very important for me to get this path into Europe, I think.
I want to show a little clip. We'll make you blush again, I suppose.
Oh my gosh.
you mentioned Plácido Domingo, of course, the great Plácido, who we love and esteem so much. I met him a couple of times. Such a gentleman.
Yes, he is. And
you went on tour with him. So let's watch a little clip and see what your reaction is. We have a little clip here. So let's see.
Oh,
I love watching you watching your clip. It's so amazing, you know, because it's not obviously a traditional opera, but it's not
programmed. You didn't tell me about that, so I'm completely.
Yeah, no, I didn't tell you about a couple of things. I just lost my audio. Give me just 1 second, because I can't hear anything. I lost my cable. My apologies.
Oh, it's okay.
Are you listening?
Okay, sorry. Now I can. Yeah.
Great. So this was actually, you chose very wisely, because this was the first concert that we did together right before.
Really?
I go to Spain and to begin my studies. Well, to continue my studies there at the opera studio, because well, I had a surprise during New Year's Eve. From 2017, after the invitation to go to Valencia that I was so happy about, I suddenly got an email, like, I think it was like one day before New Year's Eve, like 30th or so. And then I got an email saying, inviting me to, like, asking me, like, his producers were asking me, oh, dear Camila, or dear Mrs. Tittinger, I don't remember, dear Mrs. Tittinger, do you want... would you be happy to go for a concert singing with Plácido Domingo and being conducted by Eugene Kahn? And then I suddenly was like, wow. So this is
it's one of those questions. It's one of those questions, right, Leandro? They ask the question, but the answer is obvious. Yeah. It's like...
Yes, it's obvious. But and then I was like, so emotional that moment, and obviously I said yes, and it was in Ljubljana, Slovenia, and I went with my suitcase, and from there I went directly to Valencia. So it was a very important year to my life, 2018.
That's great, you were telling us, sorry, change the subject, because you were talking about the Violetta, the role that you were,
yes,
have been preparing. It would be your first one. It will be your first.
Yes, it will be my first Violetta. It will be. I won Maria Callas singing the aria, the first aria, Sempre Libera. But I never realized back then how deep is this character, and how is so. Incredible to discover it in my voice. It's incredible. First of all, I never stop singing, never. The whole opera, I'm there. You know, I think really? I will have like a small amount of time to just change clothes or something like that. But I'm always there. I'm having to build a solid resistance in my body to be able to support all this time singing and having the freedom of letting it out, the actress inside of me that I have. Because
sure,
with this character, it's so important to be not just...
I think we lost.
Hello?
There. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hopefully she will join us back.
Yeah, it would be so interesting to listen about this Traviata preparing role, because it's very challenging, actually, you know. It's she
let
just
me just
told
send
us
her a message. Can you join again the call? The beauty, yeah, of working from home, huh?
Yeah, it is. Yeah, here we
oh,
are.
Oh, she's
are.
Back. She's back. Beautiful. Great.
I got a message here, like the host ended
no.
The live streaming. Then I was like, no, it's not 1 hour now.
No, we didn't finish. Definitely not. We haven't finished.
Yeah.
So you were telling us.
About the preparation of the role.
So the thing that I was saying is that acting acting, all operas are very important, but with Violetta, I feel that I need to prepare more body into the automatic part, having my technique in an automatic part of my brain.
I think she will be back. She's back. Yeah.
Yeah.
I see that she's.
Is it my internet? Let me see.
Yeah, it's on your side because I don't think Leandro is frozen.
So I will put.
Yeah. Okay. Here we are.
I just changed to 4G. I hope it's going to be fine.
Okay. Thank you.
Great.
Wi-Fi. So basically, is that I think really that. With Traviata, it's a very demanding role, and I'm building resistance into my body, like preparing with my coach 2-3 times a week, that they are in London and also Berlin, and they are meeting me on Skype, and I've been like faking that I'm in London right now and not in Brazil with this distance, and preparing it because it will be in a short time from now. It will be, well, it is programmed to happen in October. So the September would be the rehearsals, and September
Great.
Is right there, you know.
Right there. So, Camila, how's the life of a singer during these interesting times?
Yeah, I think I automatically started talking about that because it's impossible to not feel strange and to not talk about that. I always try to see the positive side of things. So there's nothing we can do, literally, to change anything right now. This is like a invisible third war or something, you know. It's just it's very difficult to change anything from the scenario, from the picture we have in the world. So what I always think, what can I change into my life that I can profit from this moment that I'm being in a way forced to be and not forced, but I want to be at home because I want to protect myself from it as well. So I've been really taking seriously this thing of having my routine as I would be in London right now. So every time singing, forcing myself sometimes not to be so relaxed because I'm at home. This is very difficult to deal with, you know, because we are we opera singers, we are used to be on stage all the time. We are used to perform, to have the audience respond to our art. And I feel I miss so much this contact with the audience, I have to say. But I'm really exploring this introspective side of myself. Of course, that it's myself, it's introspective. But I'm really enjoying this moment to be in contact with me and to discover things about me that I didn't have time to discover or to even notice when I was running through from contracts to another, and then from some place to others, to from auditions and contracts and coachings and going to Brazil, visiting my family, and then coming back and singing. So my life pretty much this past 2 years was very busy, which is great, but sometimes I was feeling that I needed to have a time with myself. So I'm enjoying this right now as we don't have any other option.
I we were discussing that yesterday when we were driving, that the world it's going to change substantially. Hopefully it will change substantially, because you know, when with Leandro, he came to Toronto, I went to Brazil, and then I went to Europe, and every trip to Europe was exactly like what you're describing. You know, I get on a plane, I'm in London, and the day after I have to run to Berlin, and then from Berlin to Vienna, then to Salzburg, and in 1 week you go to 20 places. In the end, you don't see really a lot of anything, and you leave behind, you know, a lot of miles, not a lot of time and a lot of quality time. It's something that, you know, perhaps it would be more interesting where you're stationed in London for a few weeks or a month, and you don't have to be like the traveling is what is, you know, disrupted here, and perhaps we don't have to be traveling all the time.
Yeah, perhaps we can do things from our home, and this is opening everyone's eyes, I think, in this period. Many things we can do from our place, and of course I have to say that I enjoy the adrenaline of a life of a freelance of opera singer. I really like it. It gives me energy. It gives me I don't know, excitement. So it is very important to have a life like this, but it's also very important to have this introspective moment sometimes.
What go ahead, Leandro.
No, I'm wondering, it's not that quietful as you are studying. You must study a lot. And I'm trying to, 2 hours, 3 hours a day. How manage your agenda?
I don't know if you believe in these things, guys, but I'm Libra. I'm balanced into the sign, the zodiac thing. So I'm very intuitive. I'm very into the clouds, you know, and I'm the kind of artist that needs inspiration to have a good work as well. So that's why it's very difficult for me, without the traveling, without the purposes of having contracts to go and to do, and having the pressure of the time to get prepared. I am forcing myself now, which is good, to have a structured routine. But it is very hard for me to have this, to build this, like, oh, let's wake up every day, or more or less every day, this time of the day. And then, actually, I'm getting the chance to discover how I work. Like, okay, so every day, I got out of the bed at 8:39, and then I get my breakfast. Then I know that because I got my breakfast, it's better to wait a little bit than to sing and to practice. So being used to a freelance life, I was always with different routines. So I was like, how can I explain? I was like, I don't know, in a production, the rehearsals would happen in the morning. And then the another production would happen in the night, or another production during the afternoon. So I was always not having a routine, and this was part of my routine.
Right.
Now, surely, what I'm doing is basically establishing a solid routine. And when I say, I don't know, during the afternoon, from a little bit early than that. So some coachings I have from 12 to 1. Then my teacher do the vocalise with me, and then from that point I continue studying and preparing the roles that I have to prepare, not only Violeta, but I'm preparing also Matilde from Guillaume Tell,
really?
Rossini. Whoa. that I need to sing next year, but not so far from now. In February I will sing this role, and I'm preparing both together. And basically what I do is like studying when I feel that my voice is in a good day to study with voice, with full voice, as I would be in a theater having musical rehearsals or so, then I study for 2-3 hours maximum. I don't like to study more than 3 hours straight, you know, singing. So I do the vocalese for 45 minutes, 1 hour, then I continue 2 hours. But this is not every day, you know, Leandro. It's not, Placido used to tell me that, Camila, don't sing full voice every day. You know, study every day, but study mentally as well. Not every day vocally. He always said that, to not sing Monday to Monday, you know. It's just, it's better to do like 4 times a week, full voice, and to train the resistance of the voice and the body. But mentally, of course, I study every day. I'm always here like more than 2-3 hours, you know. I go for a coffee, come back, then I go for
and
a
you're
walk,
thinking.
Then I come
yeah.
back, then I write it down in my Moleskine that I love. I have collections of those here. Then I write all the text of the opera, then the translation, the diction, so yeah.
Great.
You're such a flexible singer in that, obviously we heard you singing some MPB, Música Popular Brasileira. You sing musicals, you sing obviously opera. Last year or the year before, you also sang the Beethoven Ninth Symphony with Osespi, conducted by none other than Marin Alsop, who, I gotta tell you, the first time when I came back to listen to classical music after a long break was the Ninth Symphony. And it was like 2014, 2015, I can't remember. And it was also conducted by Marin Alsop. I remember very well because Paulo Zott was singing.
Great.
Yes.
And I had the pleasure of having first row seats. And that day,
wow.
That day, I decided to do this, what we're doing. I was working in TV and film, and I decided to work on classical music. So I'm very attached. I love that your flexibility in your voice. Is that complicated for you to switch from one genre to the next?
And I have to add something for you, yes, because also from Rossini to Verdi, it's a very particular.
It's a different world. But as it is a serious Rossini, is very Matilde is very sometimes the cadenzas and the work that I do with Matilde as the voice should be a lyric voice with the skill of having coloratura. I'm not having such big problems with switching from Violetta to Matilde and back. Kind of the work is very similar, technically speaking. But the most important thing that is that changing styles, it doesn't have to be so, how can I say, it's such a, I don't know how is this word in English, taboo, I don't know.
Taboo,
how to say.
It's the same.
Taboo. Yeah. Okay. I sincerely think that it doesn't have to be such a taboo because, well, speaking about myself, I cannot analyze how difficult it can be for others. But what I analyze from my life is that I began singing very early. Yeah, so then I discovered, so I know my instrument so well that I can change the key of things, you know? So for me, it's not a complicated thing to do that because it's really the way I feel inside of my of me, how the song, the aria, the concert that I'm singing has to feel inside of my resonance cater. I don't know. So it's just, it's a matter of feeling and knowing your instrument. And I think I was lucky enough to be knowing my instrument when I was very young. So I always heard that when you're very young, your memory, your brain works in a very different way in comparison as I would be an adult learning right now. So I couldn't say to others, but I can say for me that I really it's all programmed in my brain, the popular style, the musical style. And then as I was growing from those styles as well, I was never stopping singing popular. Maybe this helped me. I never stopped. Like, even if I wanted, I couldn't, because when I'm in the shower, I'm singing some popular things as well. So it's impossible for me not to.
You don't sing opera in the shower?
I always sing as well. I always sing.
Oh, really?
I like to, sometimes when I, as I'm now studying a lot and preparing a lot professionally, more opera than popular music, as I have to study a lot and my concentration moments are very like into opera and to concerts and musica di camera as well, chamber music as well. So in the lyric singing, as my studies are, when I'm in my, I don't know, trying to forget anything that I have to do, that it's work, I just want to remember how it is to sing a Luisa of Tom Jobim, or yesterday, because of 7 years of Kinga, I was singing in the house one song that I was actually competing as well in this competition in the MPB Premio Visa. And I don't know, I feel great to switch, you know. Sometimes I sing O Mio Babbino Caro in the shower. Sometimes I sing, Garota de Ipanema.
The Ipanema, of course. the Girl of Ipanema, yes. You know, it's the most recorded song in the world. A Garota, yes, de Ipanema.
And I think it's the most sang in bathrooms also.
Oh, also, probably. Shower. You know, I always remember that Woody Allen film, I think it's John Turturro who sings perfectly, but only in the shower. So they have to bring the shower to the opera house, and he sings from the shower. It's so funny, you know? it's like... I'm also a great conductor, but only on the shower. That's why I never conduct outside. The orchestra loves me there. We're going to show a little clip, and then we'll come back to talk about other things. Let's see, because you said when you were very young, you're still very young, but this, you were a little bit younger. This is the New Stimmen competition, and you were singing... Mozart, let's watch a little part of it.
Oh,
Really, really amazing. 2015, I was looking at the clip.
Whoa.
you do like this. It's amazing. It's really, really
amazing,
incredible.
Yeah.
And that's the semifinal.
Yes, that's the semifinal. That's the semifinal. And actually, I was, I remember quite well that the semifinal, after the semifinal, I watched this video. And then when I watched that and I realized that I was in that competition, and when I heard the applause, and because when I was there, I remember that I didn't hear the applause. I didn't hear anything at all about, like, I was so focused into what I was doing that I didn't hear or saw anything. After I saw the video, and then I realized I was doing that, and then I got like goosebumps, and I said to myself, oh my God, Camila, you're in this incredible position, so believe that your dreams can come true. You know, you came this far, and it's just Neues Team was always for me the composure. So it was really, really incredible emotion I felt. Thank you for sharing this.
It's great to see your face. Like every clip that we've showed, you see your face and it lights up. It's most artists don't like to see themselves. You know, our actors don't like to see their movies. A lot of singers don't like to see themselves on stage. And you really light up. It's such a pleasure. Camila, I want to ask you something that I was discussing with Leandro, and we discussed it often. I discussed it on his interview, and I discussed it also with Simone Meneses a few weeks ago. Brazil is very, 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 very well known, obviously, for its music, but usually for its popular music, Tom Jobim, Toquinho, anything like a lot of samba, but not for its classical music. And yet the classical music scene of Brazil is really big. I'm very biased because I'm so attached to OSESP, and I always say that it's one of the best orchestras in the world, although nobody believes me, but it's, you know, one of the nicest halls, one of the best orchestras. There's a lot of opera. There's Teatro São Pedro, Teatro Municipal, obviously in Rio de Janeiro, Festival de Manaus. Why is it that Brazil has such a hard problem projecting itself outside of its borders in classical music?
Well, my opinion, I was asked two times about this, actually. I'm surprised that this is always also a question here, because it is very important to talk about this, and sometimes it's not remembered. We have to export more music from our country. I think, obviously, we have so much talent. You know, here we have great musicians, but I think that there's a lack there's a lack. How can I say this in English?
We say it in
there's
Portuguese.
A lack of direction. There's a lack of direction, and also investors that can give the right environment for the composers to compose, and for the theaters to have these composers and to embrace them in a way that we can produce more Brazilian classical music, and this I cannot exclude the fact that this has to come from the institutions. It has to come from that place, and also from private
entities,
sponsors,
as well. Yes, entities. So it is very important that knowledge, so to recognize, okay, we have amazing, talented people here. We need to build a name for our country into the music, into the classic music world. And for that, it has to have investors and from all of the place. I really think that there's a big lack of that in Brazil right now. And it would be great if we could focus on that to the future.
Yeah, I think the government, I hate getting political, but all the governments around the world have other problems right now to deal with. And it's true. It's really hard. I mean, fortunately, here in Canada, the Canada Council for the Arts has been really supportive of everybody, especially now during this crisis and before. Canada is known as a good supplier of opera singers, of conductors. I mean, Yannick being the music director at the Met, of course. It's probably one of the things I think me and Leandro will be interviewing more people on the institutions if they agree to come with us.
Yes,
to see what
please do that. It's great, you know.
They always run away from us.
These people can remember as well that this is very important. Not that they don't know, but actually it's true. I think arts in general is it's the last thing that the government will think about when the country is in crisis as we are. So unfortunately, I don't see much to do right now to change this situation, you know?
I think we're losing Camila.
Yeah.
Oh, she's back.
Yeah, great.
I think she's back.
Camila, you're there?
Do you see me?
We see you frozen, but we hear you.
Yeah.
Let me do some footage. I've changed here the internet again.
That's part of the beauty of doing this live from home, you know, where it makes life complicated. Yeah, and we're losing you again.
Yeah.
Hopefully she can come back. Oh, there you are. You're back here.
Right now?
Yeah, it's good. Now we can see you. We've been talking for an hour. It's all fine. We understand. It's starting to get that time of the afternoon in Brazil where everybody's on the internet.
Yes, I bet we are.
So, Leandro, I'll give you the last question of the day.
Okay, so Camila, next projects after all the stuff, you're going to sing at Philharmonie de Paris, and could you talk about your schedule to 2020, 2021?
So basically you mentioned Simone Menezes, and we are going to have
we'll be back.
Yeah, let's wait a little.
Yeah.
We're not
leaving you.
Hear me?
Yeah, we hear you.
Yeah.
It's breaking up a little.
Yeah.
Maybe not.
But what a now here. Now here.
She's coming back.
It was working so well.
Yeah, it happens every now and then. Okay, so I guess what we will do is we will post on.
Do you hear me?
Yeah, we do hear you.
Maybe we should do it by voice or better.
Are we back? Okay, so I think it froze. What we're going to do, I'm going to leave the signal up to see if she comes up. But if she doesn't, what we will do is we will leave on both our pages on Facebook. And she's starting to come back. On Facebook, and we have Falando da Música in Portuguese. And we have, obviously, the Music Café. I think she's back. Camila? I think she can hear us.
Are there?
Yeah, I think I'm back as well.
Okay, great.
I hope.
Okay. So tell us.
So I'm going to answer Leandro's a question. Simone Menezes, which you mentioned before, Alex, she invited me to sing with her in Opéra de Rouen and Philharmonie de Paris. Very happy to be part of this project. Hopefully, we are going to do that this year in October in Opéra de Rouen, Floresta do Amazonas, Opéra Lobos, and next year as well at Philharmonie de Paris. So the project I've recently, I hope they have, is going to a concert in OSESP in a new piece of João Guilherme Ripper. And Whoa. It's going to be in August. It's a monologue of a new piece that João Guilherme Ripper composed. And it's between Brazil and Portugal. And I'm not going to sing in Portugal, but I will sing here in Portugal. They will have other casts. And it's an incredible piece that I'm preparing. And hopefully we are going to be able to do that. It's from the letters of Mariana Alconforado. It's really amazing. And Cartas Portuguesas is the name. And then after that concert, series of concerts with OSESP, I would be finishing the Campos do Jordão Festival here in Brazil as well with the same piece. And after that, I would go directly to Traviata in Leeds, which is located the Opera North company, the British company there. That it's amazing. I hope that this will happen. Then after that, I would do the Opera de Rouen, Villa Lobos, Floresta do Amazonas, with Simone Menezes. And then I would be back here to sing maybe a Ninth Symphony of Beethoven again. I think in Belo Horizonte or so. So this
Orquesta is de Minas? With Orquesta de Minas? De Minas Gerais?
I don't know if it would be there. I just heard about this. And also, it could be happening Egmont of Beethoven in Minas. So it's
huge
with Fabio Mechetti. So I don't know. It's just it's some possibilities that we are thinking about. We don't know because it all depends on the situation that the world is right now. It depends completely on that. So the concert here in August depends on that. The Traviata depends on that. The concert in Minas also depends on this. So it's just we have to wait and hope that this will be in a better situation soon.
Excellent. Sure. So there is really no slowing down for Camila Tittinger.
No, absolutely. I'm glad of Brazilian really music. Hope. I'm very happy about it. Great.
I hope, Alex and Leandro. It's been such a great, Saturday with you both, and it's incredible how you're doing this Music Café, Alex, because I have to say about myself, it brought me many memories, many good moments, and during these difficult times, it's so important to have this support from people like you that has these ideas to give happiness and to also give knowledge to those that doesn't know how this world is. It's only has positive sides. Thank you very much.
Absolutely. I told Alex before, it is such an interesting project because, you know, this moment to chat about music and doing as an interview in a program, you know, focus on it. It's so important. It's so good. I have to thank him also.
I didn't pay them to say that. Thank you. Thank you very much. Camila, it's a pleasure. I do this because I love doing it. I never thought as an interviewer or anything similar, but I just do it because I think I love posing the questions that everybody who is not familiar with music, which is my case, would have. And that's why I have also Leandro with us, because he has the questions of the musicians, the, you know, everything that goes inside. But
I have Leandro here. Great. Thank you, Leandro.
Thank you for joining us, Leandro. I don't have the lineup for next week because everything is changing, but we will have a couple of interviews. Stay tuned on our channels and our feeds on Instagram and Facebook and YouTube and all of that. We will have some fantastic interviews we're working on getting for you, and we'll post them. Camila, again, it's a real pleasure. I'm so happy that you were able to take a few minutes to be with us. You're a fantastic singer, and I consider now to be one of our friends here. Thank you very much. I hope to see you very soon in Sao Paulo or wherever the life takes us.
As well, Alex and Leandro, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Leandro. We will be in touch with everybody again. And thank you, everybody, for joining us in the Music Cafe. We will see you again very soon. Good afternoon here in Toronto, and good day everywhere else. Goodbye.
Bye.